medicinal action with prolonged storage. If you're wondering how long a dry root can keep on the shelf, most dry roots last for a year. You can see how yellow dot got its name. It's due to the coloration of the root. I'm standing next to the flowering stalk of yellow dock. When you take a look at it, what you see at first is dense clusters of green flowers all around the stems of this plant. But let's not be fooled. Let's take a closer look at these tiny flowers. They are actually a pale yellow. Before going on to our next plant, you should be warned that yellow dock is contraindicated in acute inflammation of the stomach and intestines. This is a plant you probably recognize. Its name is Taraxacum officinalis, or more commonly, dandelion in the Asteraceae family. It's eaten as a food, drank as a beverage, and the entire plant is used as a medicinal herb. The young leaves, which are high in vitamins A and C, are eaten as salad greens, steamed, or as stir-fry. The flower is also high in vitamins A and C, are dipped in batter and deep-fried for food, or used to make dandelion wine. Make sure you only use the yellow flower and not the green sepals beneath the flower, or your wine will be bitter. The flowers are also used as an herbal oil applied to bruises to hasten healing. The entire plant, when broken, exudes a white, milky, bitter latex, which, when applied to warts repeatedly, dissolves them away. The root is roasted as a coffee substitute. It is also the part of the plant used most often as a medicine, although the leaf is used in a similar manner. Dandelion is a slight laxative, a diuretic, hypoglycemic, GI tonic, cholagogue, and an alterative. It's a slow but efficient agent in many situations. It's specifically used for liver and spleen congestion. Therefore, you see it used in treatment of many types of chronic skin disease and menstrual irregularities. It's also used in gallbladder disease, gout, rheumatoid arthritis, and constipation. Its main action is to stimulate the liver and kidneys. Many people eat dandelion greens as a spring tonic. Although this plant is thought of as being relatively safe, there's one word of caution I should give you before going on to the next plant. Dandelion is contraindicated in irritable conditions of the stomach or bowel where there's acute inflammation. This prickly eye catcher is Salibum marianum, or milk thistle in the Asteraceae family. This annual or perennial herb originated from the Mediterranean. It found its way here from Europe. It thrives in uncultivated, rocky, dry areas. Milk thistle has smooth, glossy, dark green leaves, streaked with white along the veins. The leaves are bordered by sharp spines. Milk thistle flowers from June until August. The flowers are solitary, arising on the top of long stalks. They are reddish purple with long, sharp, pointed bracts. The young shoots are eaten in the spring. They are boiled after cutting the spines off. Besides eating the spring leaves, the flower stalk and the roots are also eaten. The flower heads are eaten like artichokes, picking them prior to the flower opening. The plant is palatable and nutritious, as are most thistles. The whole plant has historically been used as a tea to improve the appetite, allay indigestion, and restore liver function. The leaves have been used as a galactagogue to promote milk flow. The seeds are the part of the plant used the most often. They are collected in the fall from mature seed heads. They contain an antihepatotoxic principle called silymarin. Silymarin has been shown to prevent liver damage as well as reverse liver impairment. Silymarin is famous for its protective effect against Amanita phalloides, or the death cap mushroom, and has cured severe liver damage caused by Amanita phalloides when given intravenously. Milk thistle seeds are used for both acute and chronic hepatitis. Fatty liver, especially in alcoholics, some forms of jaundice, cirrhosis of the liver, liver damage due to poisoning from chemicals, drugs, or alcohol, and varicose veins. Overall, you could say milk thistle is specific for liver and spleen congestion. Most of the herbs we have met so far grow in lower altitudes. Next, we will travel to mountainous regions to find plants who prefer higher elevations. We're in an evergreen forest with a great abundance of plants. The type of plants we'll find here are bear grass, vanilla leaf, false hellebore, lots of huckleberry bushes. The particular plant that I want to take a look at right now is Valeriana sachensis, which grows in great abundance in this area.
Valerian is in the Valerianaceae or valerian family. It's a stout, upright perennial with basal leaves as well as opposite leaf pairs, united at their base on a single stem. Many leaves are further divided into leaflets. The flowers are white or pinkish, arranged in an umbel-like fashion. Volatile oils give this plant a unique scent, which gets stronger after drying in storage. Although the flowers are pleasant, the dried root has been referred to as smelling like dirty socks. Cats are attracted to the scent, and it affects them similar to catnip. The leaves can be eaten in salad, and during the Middle Ages, valerian was commonly used as a spice and a perfume. The part used medicinally is the root. It's a carminative to settle the digestive system, an antibacterial, an antidiuretic, liver protectant, antispasmodic, stimulant, and nerving. It may seem confusing to hear this plant is both stimulating and sedating, however, it has both properties. A series of allopotriates have been isolated and shown to have both actions. In combination, they have an equalizing effect. However, the overall effect from using valerian in practice is a sedating effect. Valerian is most commonly used for its sedative effect in insomnia. It is indicated specifically when the brain circulation is feeble and there's mental depression, along with nervousness and agitation. Excessive doses have been reported to cause headache, heaviness, and stupor in some individuals, while other individuals report needing to take large doses to relax or to treat painful conditions such as menstrual cramps. It's reported to have one-third the spasmolytic activity of papaverine, which is a constituent in the opium poppy. Valerian is also used for nervous headache, nervous palpitations, and nervous excitement. The key word here is nervous. Less common uses are for indigestion and flatulence, migraines, mental depression due to stress, and hypochondria.
To demonstrate how to make a fresh plant tincture, we are going to use valerian as an example. Valerian should predominantly be made of fresh roots. However, dry valerian roots can be added at the end to make the tincture stronger. Now, making a fresh plant tincture is more complicated than making a dry plant tincture. Generally, a fresh plant tincture is a 1-to-1 strength, one part herb to one part liquid, the liquid being either all alcohol or part alcohol and part water. Today, in making our valerian tincture, we will be using all alcohol to make the situation a little simpler for you to understand. If you should decide you would like to add dry valerian root to your tincture near the end to make it stronger, I generally suggest adding at least 10% dry root in relation to how much fresh root you added. For instance, if you add 10 pounds of fresh valerian root, you'll want to add 1 pound of dry valerian root to the tincture. Calculations with fresh plant tinctures are much more complicated than dry plant tinctures. The reason is that you have to take into account the percent of water that's actually in your fresh plant, in this instance, in the roots. With a dry plant tincture, you don't have to be concerned about that. The reason is that you want to add a certain amount of water and a certain amount of alcohol. Now, if you already have water in the plant, you have to account for that and take it out of the water that you would be adding into there in your water-alcohol mixture. Today, I'm going to simplify the process of making fresh plant tinctures for you. In a future video, we will go through in detail elaborate directions on making fresh plant tinctures, as well as a variety of other types of tinctures. These simple directions you are about to receive can be used for other types of fresh plant tinctures made from roots. However, they shouldn't be used for fresh plant tinctures made from leafy or flowery parts of the herb. These parts of the plant have a higher water content than the roots generally do, and your final product would have too much water in it.
Collect these utensils and ingredients together. Start by adding 190 proof or 95% alcohol to a blender or food processor. You can add any amount of alcohol you choose. The volume of alcohol you use depends on the amount of herb you have and the final product volume you want. You may want to start by making a small batch and pour a quart or 32 ounces of alcohol in your blender. Now add enough valerian root to the alcohol to make a thin slurry. You'll need about a pound of fresh roots. Blend this thoroughly. Pour the mixture into a container. Canning jars make nice containers to use. Shake the jars every day for 1 to 2 weeks. At the end of this time, strain the herb or mark through a strainer, collecting the liquid or menstruum in a pan. Take the herb and press it out with your hands. An electric hydraulic press or a manual hydraulic press. Put the herb in your compost pile and add the remaining liquid into the blender again. Add another 1 pound of fresh valerian root to it. Blend it, bottle it, and shake it every day for 2 weeks, at which time it can be strained and pressed. You have now put the mark or herb through the menstruum or liquid 2 times. If you want to make it stronger, you can add dry valerian root to it, just as we added the fresh root. But don't add any more fresh root, as it will dilute the tincture with too much water. Once it's been pressed out for the last time, let the tincture sit for 24 hours. Pour the tincture through an unbleached coffee filter. The filtrate that you collect from this is your final product. You have just finished the last step in making valerian tincture. It is now ready to be bottled. Valerian tincture generally maintains its medicinal qualities for at least a minimum of 2 years. Next, we will visit a plant which lives in the mountainous regions as well as lower altitudes. This plant's name is solidago, or goldenrod, in the Asteraceae family. Goldenrod is a woody perennial with alternate leaves upon branching stems. The leaves are lance-shaped with smooth edges. The golden yellow flowers are both disc and ray flowers, as is common in the Asteraceae family. Goldenrod grows in dry, fertile woodlands and open areas. It's often seen in clear cuts. You can find it flowering from July to October. The plant is pleasant smelling as well as pleasant tasting. Although it can cause allergic respiratory tract reactions in some individuals, many people use it as a medicinal herb. The parts used are the leaves and flowers. The flowers are used only prior to the buds opening up. Goldenrod is an astringent, a bitter digestive stimulant, a carminative, an antiseptic, an anti-inflammatory, an anti-catarrhal, an expectorant, a diuretic, a diaphoretic, an anti-diarrheic, and a vulnerary. Its high flavonoid content lends itself to being used to treat capillary fragility. It's also used to treat such conditions as bladder and kidney infections, renal calculi or gravel, ulceration of the bladder, upper respiratory catarrh, colds, flus, fevers, menstrual irregularities, and arthritis. Wow, what a mouthful! Now let's travel to a moister environment.
Walking up to the base of a large evergreen tree, we will find Oxalis oregana. The common name is wood sorrel. It's in the Oxalis family.
This plant has green or reddish leaves which arise from a creeping rootstock. The leaves are reminiscent of an oversized three-leafed clover. On a sunny day like today, the leaves are open. However, when it becomes windy, blustery, and wet, the leaves fold down to protect themselves. The flowers are pinkish lavender or white. What is special about this particular plant is it tastes fantastic. It has a little bit of a tart taste, but it's wonderful in salads. However, you shouldn't eat too many of them because it contains oxalic acid. Oxalic acid can bind with calcium in your gut, decreasing its absorption and utilization by the body.
I'm standing amongst a dense patch of spiny covered bushes called Oplopanax horridum. The common name is Devil's Club. I'm putting gloves on because I've been prickled by these bushes before and it festers in your skin and it's really hard to get out. There's spines over the leaves, the stem, the trunk, the whole plant except the root.
This perennial shrub has thick but weakly ascending branches ending in large umbrella-like leaves with stiff spines on the veins and petioles. The greenish spring flowers arise in spike-like panicles, turning into scarlet-red berries in the late summer. The Latin name Oplopanax means armored ginseng. Ginseng because it's in the Araliaceae or ginseng family. and armored is self-explanatory once you have touched this plant. This previously little-known shrub has become more popular. I just hope it is not popularized to the point of becoming endangered, as have so many of the ginseng relatives. A few years ago, I revisited a huge stand of Devil's Club in Oregon Columbia Gorge. I was devastated to find out it had been completely ripped out of the ground, without the smallest of plants left in the wake of destruction. This kind of harvesting is unnecessary, unacceptable, as well as unlawful. In harvesting Devil's Club, you use the bark from the roots, stems, and root stems. The stems of these plants often fall onto the forest floor where they take root. This is why I call it a root stem. When harvesting root bark, it is especially important to leave the larger share of the plants untouched, since you are uprooting entire plants. Devil's Club should be approached cautiously. Most of the bushes in a thicket are interconnected. If you step on a down stem, it can cause other bushes to wave around wildly, with the possibility of you or someone else getting slapped with a spiny branch.
The medicinal part of this plant is the inner bark. There are two different ways you can get the inner bark off of this plant.
It can be cut off with a knife, which is slow and very laborious.
The second way of getting the inner bark off of the plant is to use either a rock or a hammer. With a rock or a hammer, you can pound the bark right off of the stem, and it comes off in nice chunks. It's much easier than using a knife. It goes much quicker, and you get the bark clean off of the stem. There we go. It's the inner bark that we actually want, but it's okay to leave this outer bark on it. It won't hurt a thing. There's our nice piece of bark right there.
The Native Americans use the root and stem bark internally as a tea for kidney disorders, tumorous conditions, mental illness, stress, and to stimulate the immune system. They also use the pith for stomach and intestinal cancer. Additionally, the bark was rubbed on the body to remove scent when hunting and to give the person endurance. It was also powdered and used as a deodorant and baby talc. Those native to the Northwest included Devil's Club in a group of plants they called shock medicine. Shock medicines were used to turn all serious illnesses around. This plant is presently classified as an adaptogen. Basically, an adaptogen is a classification of plants which helps us to adapt to times of stress. Presently, this plant is used for non-insulin-dependent diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis, general immune system enhancement, as well as its ability to assist the body in times of physical and emotional stress. Another plant found in the moist woods, specifically shady areas, is Adiantum pedatum. The maidenhair fern in the Polypodiaceae are fern family. It has flat, horseshoe-like fronds atop a shiny black stalk. The alternate leaflets are fan-like in their design. The black stems were used by the Native Americans externally as a hair rinse for shiny locks, as well as in basket tree design. Internally, this plant has been used as an expectorant, a refrigerant to decrease body temperature, an anti-rheumatic, an astringent, and a diuretic. Specifically, it's used in nasal congestion, sore throats, hoarseness, asthma, colds, flus, fevers, rheumatism, and for passive hemorrhage. Next, we will visit a plant which is found at sea level as well as mountainous regions. This plant is Verbascum thapsus, mullein in the Scrofulariaceae or figwort family. Mullein is a biennial herb. It begins its first year with a basal rosette of large leaves. The leaves are oblong with densely thick woolly down. In the spring of the second year, a stiff, upright stem arises from the rosette of leaves. The stem has alternating leaves upon it. It rises into a spike of golden-yellow blossoms reaching for the sky. All parts of the mullein plant have been used medicinally. The roots, leaves, stalk, pith of the stalk, flowers, and seeds. Mullein is a demulcent, especially the flowers. A weak diuretic, a mild anodyne innervating, an antispasmodic, expectorant, an astringent, and a vulnerary. It takes patience to pick mullein flowers, only a few open each day, so it can take weeks to pick all the flowers off of a single stalk. Besides having all the attributes just mentioned, mullein flowers are especially popular when made fresh into an oil. They're used for otitis media, hemorrhoids, bruises, and inflammations of the skin. The seeds have been used as a mild narcotic, to expel tapeworms, and to poison fish. The leaves are used similar to the flowers, but are more astringent and only slightly demulcent, with a tad bitter taste. The whole plant has been used to treat urinary and respiratory tract infections and irritations. The leaves and flowers are used externally in sitz baths for hemorrhoids, and as a hot fomentation for ulcers, sore throats, general inflammation and irritation of the skin. The down of the leaves was historically used for wicks and lamps, and the whole flower stalk was dipped in oil and burned as a torch.